Thank you, Tom, once again for this invitation. Really, I'm happy to be with you again and to thank you for this support, the Center for Religion, Peace and World Affairs, and Georgetown University and its Center for Muslim-Christian Understanding. Through you, Tom, John Esposito, and so many other people, I got this support from the States, helping me not to confuse the current administration with the American citizens and academic realm and professors supporting my case and helping this voice to be heard within the States. So thank you for that. Thank you also for inviting my assistant Mona Ali, who is with you on my behalf, so to say, because I think it's important still to continue our collaboration, if not in person, at least in the way we are doing it today. So thank you for that. It's a very essential topic that we are tackling today, and I want to be quite clear about the necessity of dialoguing and promoting dialogue between the Christian tradition and the Muslim tradition. But I think that we have to be very clear about some of the deficiencies that we are facing, and also some of the conditions that we have to keep in mind in order to make it better and more efficient. So I will start with a short introduction, once again a short, long introduction with three main points about what I think it's important for us today to remember when it comes to the dialogue between the two traditions. And then the first part of my talk will be about the theoretical conditions and the fundamental conditions that we need to set if we want this dialogue to be effective and to be efficient and to help us to not only live together but to work together and to be together driving forces for a better future. And then the second part will be more practical commitments coming from our respective tradition, in which way in our societies we can not only have a dialogue but also a contribution for each other first, but also for our surrounding society. So let me start with the introduction and to remind ourselves that the relationship between the two traditions, it's a very long relationship. It started with our prophet. In my last book on the prophet's life, I was referring to the relationship, and the first one to recognize the fact that the prophet, was a Christian, in fact, the cousin of Khadijah's cousin, in fact, saying to the prophet, "This is the sign of prophecy that you are bearing." So, and then we had the prophet welcoming Christians from Najran in his own mosque and letting them pray within the mosque. So this is something which is this ongoing process from the very start of the Islamic religion, from the Islamic tradition. And then throughout the Islamic history within the Islamic civilization, we had Muslim scholars dealing with very crucial issues as to the theological issues that needed to be tackled. And one of them, even though there are some discussions about the authenticity of some of his works on this, is he really the author? But Abu Hamid al-Ghazali in the 12th century was dealing with very crucial discussions and topics as the Trinity and Jesus as a prophet, as the Son of God, and this is in the Quran, but it has produced from a very long time and from the very beginning discussion. So it's not new, it's an ongoing process. It's important to remember this because we don't need and we don't want to start again things that have been done, and maybe we also have to keep alive a memory of this relationship and this dialogue, because it's something which is important in our time. The second point, which is also really important, is that we are facing a problem which is at the same time is a deficiency of what we call today the interfaith dialogue. very, you know, I have been involved in this for the last 20 years at the grassroots level. In fact, I started the interfaith dialogue not through books and theology. In fact, I started at the grassroots level when I was visiting the Brazil, for example, in South America or in Africa or in Asia. I was working with priests and people working at the grassroots level, having a very very deep commitment to their religion as Christians, but also working in the social spheres, in the social fields, and trying to promote a better life for the people, knowing that to be with God for a Christian is to serve the people, exactly what I'm saying as a Muslim. So I saw out of their behavior, out of their the way they were just trying to be consistent between their Christian values and their way of life, that they were trying just to be committed Christians in the way they were serving the people and loving God. The love is a central concept. And you know, I started in South America, in Africa, and this was my first, you know, encounter, which was in fact an interfaith dialogue without dialogue, but actions. And I started to be involved in the dialogue per se when I came back in Geneva. I was a member of the Geneva platform, interreligious platform. All this was good, and also in the World Council of Churches, in many different organizations, panels, and platforms. But there is a problem. Very often, you go from one place to another, you have this interfaith dialogue, and you meet the same people, the same specialists. And in fact, these people, they don't need dialogue any longer. They know each other, they are kind, they know about the tradition of the other. So in these specific spaces of, you know, gathering the specialists, the dialogue has been done. We get a very good understanding of what should be said, understood, and we respect each other. But the problem is that these circles, these ivory towers, in fact, of new specialists are not reaching the grassroots. And many of the people who are connected in interfaith dialogue, in fact, they are disconnected from their community. So sometimes they talk to Jewish people, Muslim people, Christian people, Buddhist representatives. All this is fine. But when it comes to talk to their own fellow Muslims or Jews or Christians, there is a gap here. There is a disconnect reality. And in fact, the people who need this more are not experiencing something which is a true interfaith dialogue. So there is something which is really important. Interfaith dialogue is important, but never forget intra-community dialogue, and to be able also to reach out, to be connected to the grassroots. And this is something which is essential at the starting of our discussion, not only to have interfaith dialogue within academia, not reaching out to people, but to have it within academia, to be able to build something which is a better understanding, and just to import, to export this at the grassroots level, and to make the people understand how it is important, how we have common value, because we are dealing with something which is a catastrophe for all of us. It's religious illiteracy. The people don't know, or they have some ideas about the, you know, I was for years teaching French literature in Switzerland, and all these, you know, students that I had at that time, they didn't know even about their own tradition. So you cannot just get the richness of the French literature, the British literature, the American literature, if you don't get this, you know, references, you don't have a sense. So it's important. Interfaith dialogue could just make us all aware that we need also to come back to a better teaching of religion in a way which is not preaching a religion, but understanding the fundamentals, the principles, and a history, for example, of a specific religion. So there is something which is important. The third point here, for me, it's whatever are the deficiencies, it's really important for us also to continue to promote interfaith dialogue, and to go beyond the dialogue per se, to be able to say, okay, look, now in America, in Europe, in the West, And not only that, you know, I was in for example, in Ivory Coast last summer, in other African countries, and I was talking to Muslims and non-Muslims in Burkina Faso. I was talking about universal values coming from a Muslim background, and I saw Christians saying, this is us, this is what we need, this is the way to come to commonalities because we have the common values. So they had the sense that something should be done in the name of our common belonging to our societies. And this is something which is really important. American citizens are now coming and having different backgrounds and religious backgrounds, but they have, as I already said, a common ground, the common legal framework within which they are living, but they are also they have also values and ethics that they are sharing. So this obsession of us versus them and our religion and your religion, first your identity is to be a Muslim, my identity is to be a Christian, and building something which is a phantasmagoric identity or a kind of imaginary identity, which is this is my religion, and not extracting from this identity the principles, and the principles could show you that you have other principles and principles in common with others. So there is something which is really essential for us here, is to continue the process and to find a way to reach out, to be able to be connected to our respective communities and to push the people towards this understanding that we have to do something together. So it's important to go from debates, discussion, conversation, as we have now, to something which is more a profound commitment towards contribution, common contribution to the future of our societies. And I think that this will be part of my conclusion. Let me now come with the first part of the talk about the condition, the theoretical conditions, but also the fundamental conditions that are needed when it comes to dialogue. Having, you know, worked in that field for more than 20 years now, and dealing with people, as I said, from action to statements, to dialogue, to verbal communication. It was much more an active, natural communication first, and then it came to putting words to behaviors. This is what I experienced out of my life in Africa and then in Europe and even in the States during these last years. There is something which is really important, is to start by saying, okay, look, what do we mean by dialogue and what are the prerequisites for a true dialogue to happen or to be experienced in the right way? I think it's important first to say the first condition of dialogue is to be ready to listen. In fact, it's not to talk, it's to be ready to listen. And I like this title of a French book stating this: talk to me, I have something to tell you. Talk to me, I have something to tell you. So first say what you have to say. And you know, even in the Quran we have this, when Musa, alayhi salam, peace be upon him, was talking to the magicians in Egypt, he said first, show me what you have to show me. And then he responded to this, saying that he's first able to listen to what they have to say. So capacity and patience and awareness, respect, starting by listening to what the other has to say. The second is to be able to speak, and this is something which is really important, is not only to be able to listen, but to be able to speak and to express one's views. And this is something which is a second condition. When it comes to dialogue, it's listen and talk, be able to talk. But there is something which is the third condition, which is also very important, is to be ready to change. Meaning by that, it's not to change in the way that you are changing your convictions, that you are changing your religion. No, to be able to change is out of this interaction, this dialectical process between you and me, I'm changing my view of you. And it means I'm changing. If I see you in a different way, it means that I'm changing. This is a psychological, intellectual empathy, which is really important, is this connection. So I'm changing. And then, more than that, by talking to you, what you are telling me about yourself is helping myself to change about my own self, my own perception of my religion. So it's not only the way I perceive you, it's the way I perceive myself. So three conditions that are so important, and we have to put this and say, okay, why are you going to dialogue? Why are you going to talk to someone? Is to change him or to be able yourself to change? Once again, it doesn't mean to change your religion, it changes the way you look at your principles. Now, if your destiny is to change, it's something else. I'm saying that there is something which is the way you are building your personality, your understanding out of this dialogue. The second thing which is important, and it's not always so clear with Muslims, to tell you the truth, and this is coming from my own experience, is to indulge into dialogue. Is it a way to convert the other? Meaning by that having forgotten about the first conditions I mentioned, is it a dialogue, a way to convert? And some Muslims, and this is why it's also really important to understand that not all the Muslims have the same idea. I'm not representative of all the Muslim trends. I'm coming from the reformist tradition, the mainstream tradition. You have some who are more literalist, you have some more traditionalist, you have Sufi group and you have rationalists. We don't agree on all things. And for example, on this field of dialogue, for some to dialogue with someone who is coming from another religion, the only intention is to change him, to convert him, or to try to find a way to convince him that our message is the only true message. This is something which is in the intention of some of the Muslims who are in involved in dialogue, and then at the same time they accept the fact that at the end of the day is not of their business. The hearts are the secrets, the God's secrets. So there is nothing that we can do. We can just try to say what we have to say. Now it's not our business to convert. But something which is really important here is if we say, no, dialogue is not this, it's not to try to convert, what is it, in fact? And I would say here, once again, three main areas where we can define what a dialogue is all about. The first one is if I'm trying to dialogue with someone is I'm just trying to know. It's a question of knowledge. Knowledge is the first main concept here. That I'm just trying to know about you, about your religion, and diversity means that I'm not like you. So before knowing who I am or knowing who you are, I'm listening to you to know, to get some knowledge. Facts, understand facts first, and elements of what is building your conviction, your religion, and your personality. The second is something which is beyond knowledge, which is understanding. Understanding is more than knowledge. It's not only to gather facts, but to understand in which way you are using, understanding yourself, these facts, to build a better understanding of your own religion and your quest for meaning, something which is really important. Having said that, dialogue is, on my side, to know the facts, to understand your approach, and then also on my side, something which is essential, to bear witness. And here we really are at the center of something which is what I'm asking to a Christian, to a Jew, to a Buddhist, and to a Muslim, in fact, is to be a witness. So in fact, you are in a dialogue and you show out of your behavior, out of the way you express facts to give knowledge to the other, and intelligence to give a better understanding to the other. You are also a witness to your message before the people around you. And this is exactly the meaning of the Quran, لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ, in order for you to be witness to your message before the humankind. This is what we are asked to do. And here, dialogue, it's to be a witness. So when I'm talking to a Christian, I'm not asking him to represent all the Christians, but to be a witness of his way of understanding Christianity and to tell me exactly where he fits in the whole landscape as a Christian or as a Jew or as a Buddhist, but here in the dialogue with Christianity, this is something which is central. I will always remember in every single book I have wrote, except the last one, because of the content of the topic, I always mention someone, Pierre Dufresne, who was a committed Christian, very active in the field of human rights, but he was just a so strong, so deep witness of his faith, love, commitment towards his religion, that this is what I was expecting from him, and it was an ongoing dialogue based on this. But they are just trying to remain good Muslims. So is to remain a good Muslim re-Islamization, meaning by that the true objective was de-Islamization, or was it that what I'm trying is just to remain a good Muslim and at the same time to be an effective citizen? So what I want is to be a citizen with my religious background and to contribute for the future of my society. But we need to listen to legitimate fears of the people around us. And many Christians have these fears and are suspicious. And this is something which is really important. So the mutual suspicion should be put, as I said, ask the question, be able to ask the question. This is something which is really essential in our relationship, as I said, asking all the possible questions, and this kind of we are losing our identity as Christians, and Europe is changing, the states are changing with all these Muslims all around. We are talking about Islam every day. So this is something that we have to acknowledge. Having said that, we can come here to all the discussion around the Pope's statement, because this was exactly what it was revealing. In fact, we knew that the Pope was a very European Pope, in fact, and he came in a time with a very strong, it's not by chance that he's here, and I'm respecting who he was and who he is, and he's asking a question, because he's scared of the reality of the continent becoming more and more secular and showing that the more practicing people are Muslims. So now he's talking about the past in a way he's saying, look, our roots are Christians and Greek. First, I'm challenging this. And you know, all what was said about violence was not the essential point. It was not the essential point. The essential point in his discussion was really about the roots of Europe. And I challenged that, saying, look, historically is wrong, scientifically is wrong, because Islam is part of the European identity. But I am understanding that he is coming to a reduction of the past because there is he is frightened from the about the present. He's just scared about the reality of this continent. So the Muslims cannot just dismiss the point, say, okay, no, this is completely wrong. He's asking a very deep question. A very deep question. So we have two choices. One option is to just dismiss the point or say, okay, look, let us come to a critical discussion about the past, which is a past of diversity. The Muslims were here in the Middle Ages. They are part of the process. They have to do with rationality. They have to do with philosophy. They have to do with the Greek tradition. They have to do with Christianity. And let us come to not to reduce the past to protect our present, but to come back to a better understanding of the past in order to tackle the challenges of the present. And this is why I'm saying, what maybe we need is not a dialogue between civilizations, but a dialogue between the European themselves, the American themselves, about who they want to be, how they perceive themselves. So here there is something which is really important. It's to acknowledge these two difficulties, and diversity is a test. It's not easy, and in the Quran we have it. We have it. Diversity is a test. If God had willed, He would have made you one community. This test is just compete in good deeds. So there is a competition for the good deeds, not for having the only truths. And I think that this is something that we have to understand. It's a spiritual teaching that we need. It's not only a structural, formalistic connection or commitment to our religion. It's a very deep spiritual meaning. What do we want? Do we want the better for human beings, or do we want only to protect or to transform our religion into something which is a new idol? We are serving God. We are serving the Creator. And He put all these religions and asking us, do your best, be the witness of your religion, and not just change your religion as something that you are worshipping so far that you are obsessed by anything which is not you, and just to oppose or to compete for only the numbers. When you start counting the numbers and saying, ah, Islam is growing, look, many, many Muslims. It's not a question of quantity, it's a question of quality. So look at the quality of the hearts and not the quantity of the bodies when you are praying. This is something which is also a very important point. And then two main points, and I will end with this, is what we also have to acknowledge and to promote is the common ground. When it comes to what I said right now, spiritual dimension, spirituality, when all the Christians and the Muslims are saying this, the same, master your tongue, master your check, your heart, try to be a better human being through education. We are all asking the same question today, how to educate oneself, how to transmit spirituality. And when the Muslims are talking about this in their mosque, the Christians are doing this in their churches, they have the same problem. How do we do that? How do we transmit this quest for meaning into a practical ethics, a daily ethics, moral values that we are respecting and we can come together? When it comes, for example, you know, we are speaking about ecology, but both the Christian tradition and the Muslim tradition have something which is ecology beyond ecology, which is the ecology of principles and not ecology coming out of catastrophe, which is respect the creation of God, because this is, you are just a vicegerent in this world. This is something that we have to come and to understand. So ecology, social justice, what is now the reality of 40 million of Americans living under the limit of what is understood as, you know, the first level of poverty? It's not acceptable in a so rich country. So where is the Christian awareness? Where is the Muslim awareness? We are speaking about the clash civilizations. We have a common commitment here towards poverty, towards something which is not acceptable in our country. You cannot eat as you eat, you, the majority of Americans, and having in your society people dying the way they are dying, marginalized, facing, you know, something which is not a dignified way of life. And then add something which is beyond this, which is the situation in Africa, the situation with millions of people dying of AIDS today, while we have the way to help them if we are not only obsessed with money and profits. This is something which is, when I speak like this, I'm not speaking as a Muslim, I'm speaking as someone who has a heart, a conviction, and he's just asking God to help him to be better and just to be consistent with his or our own values. So let us come to this, and this is something which is not only to speak about religion facing religion, but religions together facing challenges, facing problems, and to work together. And this is why I think we have to go from dialogue to common commitment in justice in economy. We need more ethics in economy. We need more ethics in politics, and this is something which is really important. One point which is also important when I was speaking about self-criticism, but this is also very clear in our daily life, to be able sometimes to see the sign of God in the other and to see the sign of the devil within our own self, within our own community. This is something which is really important. Sometimes I'm looking at people, working Christians, very sincere, devoted Muslim, helping the people, and see there are signs of God here. And sometimes I'm looking at my fellow Muslims, and what I see is really the sign that, as we say in Arabic, shaytanu shaghal, the devil is working among us and just spreading division. When we have this diversity, managing diversity is something which is great. Indulging into divisions is something which is really bad. So to be able also just to decenter our own self from our own points of reference and to be able to see the good in the other is something which is important. To conclude with all this, I think it's important for all of us in this dialogue to stop being perceived or to perceive ourselves as only dreamers of something which is an ideal dialogue. Let us be serious about it. Let us come to the ground. Let us serve the people love God and serve the people. This is something which is essential, and I think that we have to be practical here. We have to be demanding at the intellectual level, at the social level, and our daily life, and to be able to reach out, not to be in our religious ghetto with our own people saying, oh, I am open-minded, I'm ready to speak to a Muslim, I'm ready to speak to a Christian, and then we don't do anything about it. It's only an intellectual state or statement which is not helping. The point here is to come to common actions, and then to promote these common actions in our daily life. And this is what I call the new we. And Christians and Muslims as citizens should come to this, and they should be involved in this by contributing to the better of the society in all the fields I mentioned right now. And the last point, which is, very often we dream the present and we do nothing for the future. And I think that really we have to change the present and to dream together the future. And to change the present means to be committed, as I said, intellectually, religiously, never to forget the spiritual dimension of what we are doing, because at the end of the day, it's a quest of meaning, for meaning and consistency. So if we love Him, spread love. If we want to serve Him, serve the human beings. And together, once again, together. As to your sincerity, you as a Christian, you as a Jew, you as a Buddhist, I have only one thing to say. Only one thing to say. Allahu A'lam. Allahu A'lam, meaning God knows best. I don't know about our future. I don't know where I'm going to be, how He's going to judge me. I'm not going to judge you. I'm just trying to be consistent. And this is what I am trying to ask you to be for me. And this is what I call to be witness to your message before the human beings. Thank you. Yes, I think, and I wrote this, in fact, I wrote two or three articles about the topic, and I said that Muslims made two mistakes. The first one is to react on one part of the speech, which was not the most important one, about violence. This was not the main point. Mainly it was about, you know, as I said, the roots of the European identity, saying meaning for him Christianity and Greek philosophical tradition. This is one. The second is overreaction, emotional reaction. He is insulting us. In fact, he's the Pope and he's saying something which is wrong. But let us challenge him rationally, reasonably. What we need today is not to indulge into emotional reactions, is really reasonable and rational answers to a statement. And I think that there is something which was too much. But let me just say something. In the Western societies, we have to acknowledge the fact that the reactions were quite reasonable. Yes, in some countries we had this, you know, and we also have to understand that it's also used politically by some, you know, forces and some governments even. Some governments did that also just to nurture the, it's very easy for them to let their people react against the Pope's statement than to react against their own dictatorship. So this is something that we have to keep in mind. Now, in Europe, in the States, the reaction where we didn't like it, but it was quite reasonable. So it's a good sign that it's possible, this dialogue is possible. You know, all the discussion, he was willing to say, look, the Christian identity or the Christian reference or tradition should be there. And some were saying, no, say put God, and other, you know, more secularists were saying. I think that, you know, the fact that you acknowledge that there is something which is a Christian tradition in the roots of the European experience or project, it's nothing wrong with this. I don't think that we have to struggle on this. But the problem here is this, as I said, because we don't know how to deal with the diversity of today, we reduce the past. And I think it's better, if you want to say something about, you know, the religious reference, to let it be broad, because what do you want? Do you want just to say this is us against you, or this is the way we perceive us today in order to be together tomorrow? So the way you put this in words is just revealing what you have in mind. So very often this reduction of the past is just not to acknowledge the fact that the European societies have changed. And once again, I think that don't look at the European experience as if it was far from yours in the States, because you have exactly the same problem, exactly the same reality. The way you are dealing with the American nation, with the American project, is also to deal not only with communities that are perceived as a patchwork of communities, but to be able to gather a vision, a common understanding of the American project. And this means that we need to look at the past out of this acceptance of diversity in the past to be able to tackle the challenge of diversity in the present. No, I'm not sure that I heard the question right, but is it that you are saying that Maryam is revered in the Islamic tradition? Is the moderate, the mainstream view? This is what you are asking? Okay, look, what the perception is that we have one chapter speaking about Maryam, which is a central figure in the Quran. But once again, she is the mother and the extraordinary mother because there was no father. So in this, we have exactly the same conception as the Christians, no father, it was a miracle. But she is the mother of Jesus, who is a prophet and not not the Son of God. So there is something which is a deep respect, recognition that she was the instrument, the means for God to show his power and his love towards the Prophet, towards Jesus, who is once again central in the Islamic tradition. But there is no specific worship or specific status for Maryam more than she was chosen by God to give birth to one prophet through a miracle, and this per se is something that is respected by all the Muslim traditions, in fact. You know, the central message of Islam that is that it will never be one religion, maybe at the end of the time, but the main thing is God has willed pluralism and diversity of religions. And there is no way for us, and this is why, for example, I say tolerance in Islam is not enough. You have to respect God's will, and God's will is that you have to respect that he wanted many religions and to compete for the better, and you have even something which has to do with compulsion. If God, your Lord, had willed, he would have made all these people believe. Is it to you to impose onto them to believe? This is a verse of the Quran saying, but that فَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُمْ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Are you going to impose onto them to believe? This is not what God wanted. He wanted diversity and choice and free choice. So pluralism is central in Islam. It's more than that. It's a test, but a necessary test. And I just can refer here to the chapter on interfaith dialogue that I have in the book, Western Muslims and the Future of Islam, when I'm trying to elaborate on this, because it's all central in the Islamic tradition. So pluralism is central, and it means that you have to respect God's will, not to tolerate the other because you have no other choice, but no compulsion. Let him or her choose for himself and then respect his choice or her choice out of knowledge. Now, as I said, if I was to go, because when you read the Quran, it's really the people who are saying that God is three are not disbeliever, but they are denier in the fact that they are not recognizing that the last prophet came with this oneness of God, the Tawheed. My position on this is to listen to Christians. And they were explaining, and so many explained to me, look, Trinity is something which is a mysterious reality, and then we have one God. We believe in one God, but the way we understand this out of the Trinity is something which is specific to our religion. We cannot explain it rationally, but at the end of the day, our God is one God. If one Christian is telling me, I believe in one God, it's not to me to tell you, no, it's three. No, you are not a believer. No, you are. It's, look, at the end of the day, let the people define what they believe in. And what I heard from Christians, the way they are dealing with God, and even sometimes the way they are dealing with the relationship to Jesus, is really to, there is one God. So we have this in the Quran, which is Ahlul Kitab. They are coming from the people of the book, and there is something which has to do with monotheism here. So I don't agree with the concept and the content of the Trinity, but I believe a Christian, I trust a Christian when he or she is telling me, I believe in one God, I'm a monotheistic, monotheist, and this is what I believe. And I think that I have to stop here and to respect his or her position. It's a monotheism, and this is it, what it is all about. Oh, many things. It's really difficult to choose here. But, you know, when I was in South America and I was working at the grassroots level and I saw Christians giving all their time to serve the people and to be at the same time, you know, they were very spiritual, praying a lot, asking God to give them strength and at the same time very, very active. And they were not dreamers. They were not, oh, you know, it's all, this was active love. And active love is not only to say, to spread, you know, good words. It's to say, look, love is that I'm loving, liking, I'm supporting your dignity as human beings. So when there are laws and when there are systems that are preventing you from getting your rights, my love towards you is to help you to get this dignity. So these people in South America, you know, I spent a few days with Donald Del Camara, but I saw so many very more anonymous Christian priests working at that level. So this was a very great experience because, you know what? They were sending me messages about myself. What are you doing with your spirituality? Is it just to pray during, you know, to pray during the night is good. To pray during the night is nurturing your heart. But at the end of the day, to nurture your heart is to make it present during the day, is to make it alive among human beings. It's a light among human beings. It's just to show consistency in what you are trying to do. So at the end is to serve. So there is something which is important. And as I said, all the commitment of someone like Pierre Dufresne as a Christian for human rights, helping the people, listening and serving and being also very critical or self-critical, these are experiences that are very important. So in fact, what I have at the end of the whole process is, yes, lots of dialogues and words, but much more action. Yes, these are questions that are very important because we are touching here the legal dimension, is this possible or not? And, you know, the mainstream answers coming from Muslim scholars, but once again, it's not new, these are old answers, is really, it's possible, but you have to clarify the scene. It's not to go to another celebration and just to pray as they pray or to worship what they worship. It's not this. The limits are be who you are, believe in what you believe, and you can go and just witness what the people are believing in. So there is something which is, you know, for example, when some of our fellow citizens and someone that we know passes away or something happens, some of the Muslims are not going. It's not lawful. This is one opinion. The great majority are saying you can go, you can just assist, and you can just show your respect towards the people around you. So showing respect, witnessing, or watching or attending ceremonies like this, as long as you are not asked yourself to do something which is against your conscience. And then when the people are doing something that concerns them, you can just refer to what you believe, but don't avoid being with the people. And this is, by the way, the prophet of Islam let the people pray in his mosque. In his mosque, while the companions didn't want this, he let them in. So there is something which is from the beginning to understand. So as long as you are not asked to do something which is against your conscience and your prescriptions, you can go. And one advice, let the people know beforehand what are the limits of what you can do or not. It's just sometimes a question of explanation. Some Muslims are not going because they are scared of what could happen. Just explain before. Go to the people, sit down, say, okay, look, these are the things that are worrying me. And this is a question of dialogue. And to do this, it's the way to build trust among the people. So it's a question of dialogue. It's a question of So psychology is not only a question of legal or illegal, halal, haram. Sometimes the people can't understand that there are things that you cannot do, and they are happy, and they will be more than happy just to respect you and to show you that they respect what you your prescriptions. This is a good question, because I think it's the more difficult thing to do. There is a deficiency. We are experiencing something which I think that the Muslims can acknowledge this, that there is something which is a crisis, an authority crisis, because we have so many people speaking in the name of Islam. And I think that at least we have to accept that there is an accepted diversity, but we need to manage this. We need at least to have platforms where the people can come. This is missing. Intra-community dialogue between different trends, it's not there. Just after July the 7th, for example, this is something which was practical. I was condemning what happened, and I was saying that all this business about, you know, being against the British society. And when I was talking and giving lectures, it happened in many countries in Europe, and mainly in the UK, I had some groups coming and challenging me and just saying, no, we want Sharia, we want a caliphate, and all the means are possible because we are oppressed and these countries are oppressing the Muslims. And they were coming to the lectures, and there was a discussion in the government, should we ban this kind of expression? And my position on this was, look, if there is someone saying something which is against the law, you cannot just let him say. And I said this 15 years ago, don't let the people say that we can kill a prime minister, as it was said about John Major in the UK. This is not acceptable. But while they are talking within the limits of the law, let them speak, because it helps us to challenge them. So I was challenging them, saying, look, what about this, and what about this, and what are you saying, and what about this verse, and what about this? And you are challenging their ideas, because if you don't challenge them publicly, they will go underground and nurture this, you know, radical views, and nurturing also the victim mentality that we are not like, and Islam is against them. And I think it's really important. So we are facing a lack of intra-community dialogue. And one thing that I want also to say, you know, the radicals are already on the other side, so to say, ready to kill. It will be difficult to reach them. But there is a gray area where some young and not so young Muslims can be attracted by different trends. Here we have to work. We need this Islamic education. We need to reach out. And by the way, there is something which is really important. It's not only a Muslim business. When I am with Christians and Muslims and having dialogue and being able to say, we have common values, we disagree on that, we agree on that, we are building the future, and we have a common ground, which is social justice, human dignity. When the people see this in their society, they see that the Christians, the fellow citizens, are giving value to the presence of the Muslims. And this is really important. It's a very strong psychological message helping to give value. It helps what I call the psychological integration. The Christians should never underestimate the role in helping this process within the Muslim community by their presence, their questions, and their commitment. No, that's right. It was never done in the name of Christianity. But we heard everywhere, and never forget that, never forget that everywhere in the Islamic majority countries, and here even in Europe, we heard the president of the United States of America referring to God at the time that he was launching a war. It was not done in the name of Christianity, but the religious reference was there, and this was a mistake. The second mistake after the first one, because the first one was to speak about crusades. So let us say that I am aware, I will be the first to say, what was said at that time was not the Christian view and the mainstream Christian understanding of what Christianity was about. And these were, for me, clumsy statements. I know that, and this is what I'm spreading around. But don't, once again, underestimate the impact of such statements in the Muslim psyche. What is it? What is this use of religion at the highest level of the American government? So, no, it was not done in the name of Christianity. And many Christians, many American Christians were against it. And everywhere throughout the world, we have people saying this was not something to do, because Christianity has nothing to do with launching war in that way or in any other way. So I'm aware of that. I was not saying this, but I was telling you, this reference to the Christian or the religious dimension was really, really scary and disappointing and revealing something, which is be careful not to misuse Christianity even in the name of a war presented as a way to democratize another society, and we know what is the situation today. So I'm not confusing this at all. I'm quite aware, and I'm really, really very demanding on this among Muslims not to confuse all this. And I would say exactly the same when Muslims are killing people in the name of Islam. This is not acceptable. It's not at the same level, but I'm speaking about the impact, the perceptions on the other side of such statements that are really damaging, and we have to be very cautious, very careful, and is for all the Christians. As I know so many who are very, very critical towards this kind of political posture taken by the current administration.